Good morning and welcome. My name is Karen Morikas, and I'm your worship associate today. I'm very happy to welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Long Beach. I'd especially like to welcome newcomers and visitors today and encourage you to join us for our virtual coffee hour after service. Today, we have the pleasure of hearing from Michael Esselin, an oncology chaplain, an inspirational speaker, and a native of Long Beach who has spoken in our congregation many times. So I invite you today to bring your whole self into worship, body, mind, and spirit. Take a deep breath. Relax. Open your spirit to the morning. Today, we gather in love. We gather with our individual joys and sorrows, and we gather as a people of shared values. Welcome. We light this chalice as a symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith, which honors the sacred life within everyone. Come, let us pause to savor this hour of sharing community and inspiration. Let us give our bodies, our minds, and our spirits permission to rest and be at ease. Come, let us worship together.
I invite us to close our eyes and get comfortable in our seats as we move into this time of silent reflection and contemplation. As we breathe a few nice deep breaths together, we quiet our minds. We let go of the concerns of the day, the week behind us, and the week ahead of us, and we simply follow the empty breath. We come back to that image of that place within us, the part of us which just may be indestructible. Whatever that place, that essence is, we don't need to give it words. We simply breathe into it, that core of our being. From that place, we move into silence, in community.
Good morning. I'm Grace Lawrenson from the Green Team here at church. Every month, our church makes a special collection to a local organization that reflects our values. The collection for this month is East Yard Communities for Environmental Justice. See my shirt. Our church has participated for many years with East Yard in addressing air quality issues, which disproportionately affect underserved communities on the west side of Long Beach. East Yard also led us on the toxic tour of Long Beach, which was part of our district assembly in 2019. Please watch their video and then donate generously. Thank you.
In Long Beach, you have the largest port complex in the United States, where 40% of all the goods imported into the US come into the country there, which means you have tons of train and truck traffic that comes from the ports up into our communities to four rail yards in the City of Commerce in East LA at the northern portion.
Growing up, I saw the rail yards all the time, but I never really knew how toxic they were to my health, to my family's health.
The rates of asthma are really huge, heart illnesses, and then also cancer as well is really common.
This is not normal. We're living next to these freeways when we're living next to these industries that are often polluting our communities and contributing to these health problems.
Why is it that there's three cancers on the block when before there was none? So folks started to ask the questions and really start to talk to each other. And that's really how East Yard formed.
This work is very communal, it's very community-based, and it's also very family-oriented.
East Yard Communities for Environmental Justice focuses on building grassroots power, building community leadership to fight for justice for our communities.
I work predominantly with the young students, and one thing that always excites me is when students get excited also about the work that we're doing. To see those aha moments of like, wait, I knew something was wrong, and now there's a place and a space that I know I can do something about it.
I remember they did a classroom presentation in our class. It was a very eye-opening moment, and that's how I started to get more involved with East Yard.
There's no way that one person could possibly win against these issues. It really takes whole communities to fight back.
We've shut down Exide. We're now very active members in the LA River work plan for the master plan of the LA River. Community members have also created La Cosecha Colectiva, which is our gardening component. And we also have the Ride on Our Roads, which is our biking component.
One of our more recent victories has been shutting down an incinerator. It receives trash from other neighborhoods. And so we kept fighting legislation year after year, and eventually the business isn't profitable without state subsidies. And so we were able to get it shut down. For us, this isn't a job, this is a fight. The East Yard slogan is fighting for life. We're literally fighting to preserve our lives from the attacks of industrial pollution. But we're also gonna fight for our entire lives. That's not gonna end.
Come out to our events, come out to our meetings, come out to support.
Funding our movement is really, really powerful so that we can continue it.
Collections, East Yard communities, either text to give and say special collections, or send a check and make sure you write special collections in the memo line.
Good morning. As a reading this morning, I would like to share an excerpt from the Los Angeles Times, dated March 11, 2012. It's a reflection from Mike Nichols, the well-known American film theater director, producer, actor, and comedian, as he was embarking upon directing a revival of Death of a Salesman on Broadway, starring Philip Seymour Hoffman. It is Willie Loman's singular tragedy that he can't understand that true success, says Nichols, is simply the ability to change. Willie can't understand the joy of changing yourself, even by a millimeter. Even if you get 5 millimeters of difference in your life, not bad, he says. His eyes behind stern, dark-rimmed glasses suddenly moisten. I don't like to talk about my kids, but their ability to learn and adjust and change moves me more than I can say. It's the one characteristic you want for them. Learn, do something else, change. In Death of a Salesman, the diamond shining in the dark, hard and rough, turns out to be death itself. While Nichols once said, "Get the world to revolve around you and you think you're never going to die," he says that he has no such illusions. Oh my God, if I know anything, I know I'm going to die. I never forget that. I know I'll be forgotten in a minute, and that's just fine with me. He tells the story of watching the film Elizabeth one night when he couldn't sleep. He was stunned by how good the Cate Blanchett movie was and how gutsy its heroine, Queen Elizabeth I. The next morning, over breakfast, he told Sawyer about the movie, how Elizabeth stood up to the Pope, killed all her enemies at the same time, just like in The Godfather, and was not only right, but right forever. And recalls Nichols, "Diane said one of the greatest things she ever said to me, if forever matters." As Death of a Salesman points out, it is the love or damage that a spouse and parent leaves behind in the here and now that ultimately matters. Everything else is a delusion, says Nichols, and that's what I'd like on my tombstone. If forever matters. In this time of the pandemic, all of us, it seems, are deluged with dozens of unanswerable questions, each one competing for our limited attention and capacity to focus. How long is this going to last? How are we going to make it financially? How do I keep myself safe? How do we live with this kind of uncertainty? As we vacillate between one question or another, whichever happens to be working us over at any particular moment, there might in fact be one question that lies beneath all the others. What matters? As you know, I serve as the chaplain at the Sims Mann UCLA Center for Integrative Oncology. And last fall, as a part of the UCLA Centennial, I was invited on behalf of the UCLA Department of Arts and Architecture to be a presenter at their special 10 Questions event, the Centennial Edition. It was a series of 10 evenings, each one devoted to one particular question for our life and times, each one to be explored by a multidisciplinary panel. When I told my husband, Scott, about the honor of having been invited, he, of course, asked me, "What's your question?" "What matters?" I said. "Oh," he said, "everything and nothing," and then he left the room. Pithy, yes, but also kind of true in a way. Everything matters and nothing matters. Our own individual lives, such as they are in this very moment, are in fact a culmination of countless decisions and choices we've made over the course of our lives, both large and small, each one informed, shaped by our sense of what matters. Do I marry this person or not? Do I live in this city or not? Do I pursue this career or not? Or on a whole other scale, do I buy this pair of shoes or save my money? Do I eat that last piece of chocolate cake or let it pass me by? Each decision is shaped by our sense of what matters. On a national scale, we only have to look less than a year ago at our own Democratic national primary debates to get a cross-section of what matters. Day one of my presidency will be addressing healthcare reform. Day one for me is looking at climate change. Day one for me is cleaning up the corruption in Washington or the catastrophe happening at our southern border. And it all matters. But look at what has happened in the span of less than a year. In just very few months, really, all of that has been trumped, you should pardon the expression, by the COVID-19 pandemic. Does that mean all of that doesn't matter anymore? Of course not. It just means that this matters more right now. This captures our attention. But on a whole other scale, do you know what else matters? That you get home safely from your next outing to the supermarket, or that we have enough cat food, that Rupert's been fed, or that I have milk for my oatmeal tomorrow morning. I think what matters ultimately is the thing right in front of us, this very moment. I remember in the early 80s reading a magazine interview with Rosalynn Carter. This would have been not long after she and Jimmy had moved out of the White House back to their home in Plains, Georgia. At the time of the interview, I remember she was busily engaged in laying a new brick pathway up to the front stoop of their house. She commented to the interviewer with some amazement, to reflect that just very few months earlier, she and Jimmy had been living in the White House, hosting state dinners, Camp David Peace Accord, all of that. And now, the most important thing in the world is that this brick is straight. "And it matters," she said. "Though I was such a young man, I was so struck by the profundity of that, so much so that it still sticks with me 40 years later. It's kind of Zen-like, isn't it?" Around the same time, I remember taking some kind of self-development seminar or another. After all, it was the 80s, in which we were given the task of writing our own epitaph. Now, if you've never tried that task, it can be daunting, but also illuminating. It becomes even more daunting when we have to do it for real. My mom died a year ago. Last April. You know, there's only so much room on those little bronze plaques, only room for very few words. Which few words are you going to choose to summarize, to encapsulate an entire human life? What I chose for myself in my 20s was, "He was moved by life." I think what matters is really quite fluid and changeable over the course of a lifetime, maybe even over the course of an afternoon. What mattered to me at 25 is not what mattered to me at 45, which bears little resemblance to what matters to me today at 65. I think in the first half of life, we are so focused on achieving our goals, accomplishing something, achieving success, as if we have the vaguest idea what that really means. Second half of life is a little different story, I find. And yet one inescapable truth for all but precious few of us is that a couple of generations from now, no one will know or remember or care that you even walked the earth. So given that reality, what matters? I have to come back to Rosalind Carter, that the bricks are straight. And yes, while I'm focusing on this brick in front of me, I have to pay attention to all the overwhelming problems that plague our world. But when it comes time for me to take my last breath, what will I say matters then? In my role as an oncology chaplain, I would say I'm sort of in the coming out business. I'm creating a safe space for people to come out to me, to tell me their truth, often their deepest truth, and often at the most critical time of their lives, at the end of it. But the way I see it, it's not only a coming out business, it's also a meaning-making business, because once that truth is out there on the table, how do we contain it? How do we hold it? How do we make sense of it all? That's part of the gift and exhilaration of doing this work. Every day, I get that constant reminder, Michael, pay attention. Particularly as I move well into the third act of my life. When I reflect back on Acts 1 and 2, I realize how seldom it was that I was ever focused on the brick in front of me. I always had my eye around the corner to the next decision, the next choice. How does this one affect that one? Which class do I take? What do I major in? What career do I pursue? Which relationships do I nurture to get me closer to wherever it is I think I want to go? And in a way, that's still true, but perhaps with less urgency. But then again, maybe with even more urgency, because at this stage of my life, the big what's next for me is the home stretch, the final reckoning, as it were. So when it comes time for me to take my last breath, what will I say matters then? There are, of course, as many answers to that question as there are individuals on the planet. And yet I do hear some common themes expressed by folks who are facing that very question when deciding whether or not to sign up for guaranteed more suffering with the next chemo, the next drug trial, the next surgery, the next radiation. What is it that makes life worth fighting for? Well, I'd like to live long enough to see my son graduate high school or college, or to see my daughter get married. I'd like to see my grandchild be born. Still, I find those to be deceptively simple and tidy answers, not really revealing the larger picture, the whole truth. I remember many years ago, I was assigned to the inpatient bone marrow transplant unit at UCLA. Leukemia and lymphoma patients mostly, who often spent many weeks, if not months, in the hospital. And there I met Leon, who was a difficult, prickly, not at all likable guy. In all of his weeks in the hospital, I never saw that he had a single visitor, and he was sort of proud of that. I don't need anybody, he would say. He had his own business, and he had a dog who scared the neighbors. Leon identified as an atheist, a secular Jew, and he presumed I was religious and Christian, neither of which, of course, are true, but he used to enjoy duking it out with me, philosophically speaking. That was the nature of my spiritual care. We would engage in these deep theological discussions. Once he got his bone marrow transplant, however, things went south pretty quickly. And the doctors came in with that awful news, nothing more we can do. Well, then his heart began to soften up and the tears came. But the very next day, the docs came in and said, wait, there's one more drug trial we think you might qualify for. Oh, his spirits went through the roof, mine too. This is great news, Leon. Tell me, what are you going to do with more time if you get it? I eagerly wanted to know. I'd like to finish my invoicing, he said. My heart just sank in total disappointment, I admit, and judgment. I was not a good chaplain in that moment. I did not ask the next obvious question. Oh, that's interesting. Tell me why your invoice is so important to you. No, I just sat there in total judgment, really. I guess I was hoping he'd say, I'd like to walk my dog one more time on the beach, or I'd like to see one more beautiful sunset. I'd like to hear Rhapsody in Blue one more time. No, he said, I'd like to finish my invoicing. That's where he found his meaning. That's what mattered. Mary Ann was in her mid-40s. She had lived the previous several years with pancreatic cancer, and I walked the last few months of her journey by her side. I went to see her in the hospital not long before she died. She was hooked up to every kind of tube and pump and hose imaginable, absolutely cooked and fried. Michael, I'm just done. Ready for it to be over. But it wasn't an option, because her husband and her kids, of course, wanted her to keep fighting, try the next drug trial, the next chemo, try the next surgery, get a second opinion, a third opinion, a fifth opinion. I can't die, she said, having them think for the rest of their lives I didn't love them enough to keep fighting. Do you think that's what they're going to think of me? What do you want, Marianne? If you could call the shots right now. Well, that's easy, she said. I would disconnect all of this. I'd ask my husband to get in bed with me and hold me and look out that window across the room at that tree across the street and say, look at that leaf on that tree fluttering in the breeze. Look at how it catches the sunlight. Isn't that beautiful? A God moment, she would call it. Over our months of conversation, she had told me about other God moments, moments that sort of anchored her into life, moments in which not much really happened, but the stuff and business of life just fell away, leaving room, space for an awareness of this moment being enough and being beautiful. I'd like one more God moment, she said. I met Evelyn on her first day of chemotherapy after having been newly diagnosed with ovarian cancer. She came to see me every couple of weeks for the next 6 years for a session. Though she never wanted to talk about anything of any more consequence, it seemed, than what she and her husband Gene had done the previous weekend. Despite all my invitation, holding the door open to talk about the other deeper themes and questions that are coming down the pike, she never took the bait. I didn't feel like I was doing much of anything as a chaplain, but she would always conclude each visit by thanking me. Oh, Michael, thank you so much. I always feel so much better after talking to you. I went to see her in the hospital the day before she died. She and her husband Gene were there, of course. They'd been married just forever. No kids, though. High school sweethearts. The Buddhists think it's a good idea to reflect on the sweet memories of life when one is about to make their transition as a way to maybe grease the wheels for the next incarnation. No matter what our beliefs are about such ideas, it's not a bad idea. So I asked Jean, tell me that story again about how you guys met. I love that story. And he launched into the story, and Evelyn soon enough got a little distressed. She didn't remember. Undaunted, Jean pressed on. Oh, sure you do, honey. Remember we went to that football game and we were in the back seat of the car? No. Now she was very irritated. The memory was gone. Forever. So Jean changes course and says, that's okay, honey. Maybe you're just tired. You want to rest. Tell you what, Michael and I will go out in the hall. We'll chat a little while, give you a chance to rest. How about that? No, she said defiantly. I want you both here. I just don't want anybody to talk. And so I sat on one edge of the bed, and Jean sat on the other edge of the bed, and we each held a hand. And we just sat there in silence, looking at each other. There's absolutely nothing to do, nothing to say. Just holding this space of love. For the rest of my life, that scene has imprinted my heart of what truly sacred space looks like. Perhaps what matters most is what's left when everything that we thought had mattered has burnt away. So what matters to me now, today? This conversation matters. Kindness really matters. Friendship, love, of course. Being a witness to one another in our lives, kinship. Communion, an old-fashioned religious word, but I love it, the imagery of it, taking in and digesting our common humanity, our connection to each other, to nature, to the source of life. That matters. Sure, I'd like to think when I am breathing my last breath that I will be thinking I made a difference, that I relieved some suffering here and there, I provided some encouragement, that I had a blast, that I saw the world, that I loved hard. But I'm not so delusional as to think it was ever anything more than one conversation at a time, one brick at a time. We go through our lives making countless choices, having countless contacts and conversations, a little encouragement, a little support here and there. Those encounters might have the farthest reaching impact of anything we ever do. They might, in fact, be our greatest legacy. Joseph Campbell says he believes it's important for us to realize the eternal within, that we are to participate with joy in the sorrows of the world. To participate with joy in the sorrows of the world. I come back to that again and again as a kind of mantra. I don't know. Maybe it just comes down to being moved by life. So be it.
We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change, alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love.
I invite you to perhaps close your eyes and take a few nice deep breaths together with me, breathing in the love, the intention, the commitment of this community to come together and to connect despite all that there is now to separate us physically. As we exhale, can we release the light and the radiance of our coming together, not only back to one another, but to the larger circles of life? Let's even stretch our arms out right now, right where we are, right where you're sitting, and imagine our embrace of each other in those larger circles of life, getting a sense of our connectedness in a place beyond time and space, despite the physical isolation of this moment. As we breathe into that embrace, let's absorb the words of the poet Rilke as a blessing to ourselves. Be patient toward all that is unsolved in your heart. Try to love the questions themselves like locked rooms and like books written in a very foreign tongue. Do not seek the answers which cannot be given to you, because you would not be able to live them. Live the questions now. Perhaps you will then gradually, without noticing it, live along some distant day into the answer. So be it.
One, two, three.
Gonna lay my burden down, lay my body in the ground. Cold clay against my skin, but I don't care at all. Can't seem to find but peace of mind. So with the earth I'll lay entwined. 6 feet underground, my feet are warm and dry. When I get to the other side, I'll put your picture way up high. But I'm not coming back to you, it's just too far. If I was cast up on the sea, would you come? Thank you. fly all night, a day to night. Touch down upon a branch and scan the crowd for you. When I touch my feet on the land, I'll kiss your lips and take your hand. But you know I'm not here to stay, I'm just too far. Darling, can you hear me cry? My bones are broke, my tongue is tied. The moon is waving back and forth against the navy sky. Is all that I can see. My body's trembling on my knees. Just have a little mercy on me. Run away.
Hello, UUCLB. Everyone on our auction team is working very hard right now on the auction, but we do not have enough donations to make the service auction happen. Please go to uuclb.org/donate now to give us your workshops, delivered meals, Zoom dinner parties, patio parties, themed events, Zoom wine and beer tastings, and other creative events. They're all needed now. If you have any questions, you can email Mimi Gephardt-Seeley at winterlight@uuclb.org. Please, please donate now and save the date for the live Zoom event on January 30th at 7 p.m. The auction basket team also needs your donations in order to create the amazing silent auction basket items or this year's basket door prizes. We need your help. Please go to uuclb.org/shopbaskets for information on themed basket ideas or be creative and make your own. We can pick up your items as well. Any questions? Email Mimi Gephardt-Seeley at winterlight@uuclb.org.